So not too long ago, Mukhileru frequented this very department, graduating in 1972 with a BCom and an LLB.
After, quite a long time ago.
We'll see how much has changed. After working as managing director at Distillers, or now Distell, in the 1980s and 1990s, he found Capitec Bank in 2001. He was CEO of this highly successful banking group until 2004 and is still chairman of the board today. Under his leadership and vision, Capitec grew into one of the most successful, innovative and consumer-friendly commercial banks in South Africa, and in fact, the fastest growing commercial bank. And all of this in a remarkably short time.
Leadership is a very philosophical concept. I'm a businessman. I think in business you like to do things and you like to plan actions. So I'm skeptical of thinking too philosophical about concepts and not about implementation. I mean, ultimately leadership is about getting other people to do what you think they should do. And everybody does that every day. So in a sense, everybody is a leader. And in business, there's a structure, there's a hierarchy, it's different, it's not leadership. And universities, for instance, a very different organization from a business. But in a business environment, I've learned a few tricks of the trade. I don't think they're important, terribly important, but not necessarily true in every situation. But for instance, I think if you want people to do something, you've got to be very clear about what you expect of people. You've got to have a clear plan. They can't ask people to work a plan if they don't know what the plan is. I've also felt that it works well. You've got to know everybody well. You've got to know your situation and your people. If you tell people what to do and you don't understand the situation, you don't understand their problems, you quite often end up like a schoolmistress who's simply unhappy with the results and always scolding people like children, which I think is counterproductive. If you deal intelligently with people, they reward that intelligence. In other words, I think leadership is much more about substance than about style. There's not a trick of leadership. If you know exactly what you want to do, I've seen a lot of very smart leaders. I'm talking business. Politics is different. University is different. Students' affairs is different. But I've seen very smart leaders who at first glance don't at all seem impressive. They're not people, when they tell jokes, it's not very funny. When they make speeches, they're not very comfortable. And yet they know exactly what they want to do. And when they sit down with their team, they discuss matters and they make plans, they end up and people say, now that can work. And they inspire them and they have huge successes. So if there's one thing I would say leadership is much more about substance than style. People think about style quite often, to me at least, they seem very superficial leaders. You know, they tell people, let's do it, but they don't explain really what to do and how to do it. I don't believe in threatening people. I don't think it ever works really to try and catch up people that do something wrong and then threaten them with dire consequences. In practice, if you have smart people, you should reward them when they do well. And if people don't do well, if they're not smart enough for your team, then you must get rid of them. Nothing is more powerful than getting rid of people. That's a really powerful message in business. And that's much better than a threat and all sorts of dire consequences. The university is a pretty old-fashioned place now. They talk a lot about being future-focused, but in practice, it's pretty much the opposite. It's everything that exists has been created by things in the past, and it sort of has a momentum of its own and carries on along a predetermined trajectory. So I'm skeptical of the ability of big organizations to renew themselves. They live their past. They look at what's happened. They look at what's worked well. big organizations become very conservative. Our university is a very different organization from a company. Certainly in our business, we think our biggest advantage is that our competitors are big banks. They're highly successful, they're very profitable, and it makes them very complacent and relatively easy to compete with. They can never change something. I mean, one of the first things that happened when, as you've heard from Emily, I went into banking after I'd been in the liquor industry for 20 years. The liquor industry is a very marketing-driven industry. My best example, which is always vodka. Vodka is pretty much of a neutral spirit. It's the same alcohol whether you buy brand A or brand B or brand C. You get 43% pure alcohol diluted with pure water. There's hardly any taste. A lot of consumer studies will show that very, very few, hardly anybody can taste the difference between different vodkas. Yet you can sell one bottle for 190 rands a bottle and the other one is 45, 65 rands a bottle. Why? Because the one guy is a good marketer. He's attached a beautiful story to his vodka. The next bottle is just a bottle of vodka. And so that applies to marketing. Banking, on the other hand, is a lot about substance. The card you have, the access to money, the interest rates you get when you pay, these are real differences. So banks care less about marketing. They think they do, but all they really do is they employ expensive advertising agencies to create a bit of marketing vibe. But they don't create the product with the client in mind. So one of the first questions I asked when I came into banking is, why do banks close at 3:30? I said, it's just crazy. And nobody could give me an answer. And we said, well, let's stay open to 4:00. And we had pretty much a revolt. Well, that's before I was joined we started Capital, so the previous Holland bank, a small bank in the pub, that state. And I remember one of the guys told me, but I joined a bank because I like sport and I want to be off the afternoon after 4:00. Well, I'm sorry. But this is not the way we see this future of this particular bank. You know, the question was, how do you stay future focused? For big organizations, it's extremely difficult. Extremely difficult. It depends on individuals. I wish the new rector success. I think it's always important to have fresh blood. If it's important to have outside influences. Too many big organizations reappoint people from inside. And the old guy retires and the new guy comes from inside. He's got the same ideas, it comes from the same background, and the organization just cruise. And when you just cruise, you tend to lose eye.
Do you think you would have been able to start Capitec Bank without the Bullet Bank experience?
I don't think so. We started Bullet Bank was to me a very big learning experience. It was a organization which was pretty much in trouble by the time I joined them. And then I discovered something interesting, and that is that that I learned a lot more from a poor organization than I ever learned from a good organization. When I joined the Stilles Corporation, it was, and I think it's still easy, a well-run organization, profitable, good people, good systems. And when I ran that business for 40 years as CEO, and I enjoyed it, but with the benefit of hindsight, when I look back, I think I could have done a lot more. I think to some extent I did what I just criticized of big organizations. I continued what I thought was good practices. I didn't try to be drastic and reinvent. Then I went to Boland and it was on the wrong way. There was lots of things that was terribly wrong. And it was, I thought, pretty obvious. So when I joined as CEO, I had to make a lot of changes. And once you start making changes, you start to rethink where should we be? Why make a small change? Why not make a big change? If this little thing is wrong, well, maybe it's part of a bigger problem. So you start thinking out of the box. So suddenly, the lesser knowledge was enabled me to see a bigger picture. When I had a lot of knowledge, I saw the trees, and when I had less knowledge, I was able to see the woods and say, what are we trying to achieve, and why are we not successful? So in a funny way, I thought that I learned a few lessons. You can learn more from a poor country. Learn more from your mistakes. I mean, it's a very old man thing to say to young people. Because when you lose a rugby match against a small country, you learn a hell of a lot. You go back and rethink everything. When you win that match, you learn nothing. You go back and you have a beer and you say, oh, that was a nice game. Who are we playing next? But I think South Africa is competitive enough to make one smart enough to reward you on the big scale if you're successful. But South Africa is not so competitive that it crushes you unless you're the best. America is a highly competitive environment. That's why it's the world's biggest economy. It is really a highly competitive environment. To succeed there, you really need to be the best. And to succeed in South Africa, you can succeed with lesser qualities. Now, is that sounds like a backhanded compliment, but we're all human. Very few of us are Steve Jobs and can create Apple. So if you've got the ability maybe to create a mid-sized company, I don't know, I can't really tell you of America. But I can tell you in South Africa, there are plenty of opportunities. It's a big enough country that you can find access to markets, access to financing. This is one of the most difficult things for South Africa. I mean, on the one hand, there is this sense that it's clearly an unpalatable situation, an untenable situation, that you have discrimination for generations against a group of people. Then you take away the discrimination and say now you can compete, and that's that. So the need to create an opening for black businesses is obvious and logical. At the same time, business is a difficult environment to do that. My experience of BEE is that BEE has flourished as a share scheme, and it's made a group, some people rich and some people very rich. But it hasn't really created a black business environment. And to some extent, it's done the opposite, because the opportunity of making a lot of money by getting a stake in a bigger company is so lucrative that people with the ability to start a small business and work hard, but with all the challenges that maybe you work for 10 years and you have nothing, it doesn't really seem so attractive compared to the ability to start, to go for a BEE deal, and then you become a deal maker and not a real entrepreneur. So it's been a two-edged sword. Is there a better way? I don't know, it's difficult. Right? So ultimately, my logic tells me that the business readjustment should be about cash, about access to money. To distribute something like opportunities is very difficult. But how do you distribute cash? How, to whom, where? So I would support straightforward, superficial ideas that's in any way supported, like more support for small business. But then again, I would probably say if you could find a good formula for supporting small business while limited to black business, and then it wouldn't be a BEE scheme, it would just be a small business scheme. Capitec's biggest, the single reason for the success of Capitec has been in the word focus. We've done very few things and tried to do them very well. And we've tried to standardize. And for instance, our branches are all pretty much the same size. We don't have giant branches and small branches and satellite branches. In my mind, the Redis who really is the creator of Capitec Bank is the CEO, he's just retired, Rian Stassen. And Rian was with me at Capitec Bank, at Boland, at Distillers Corporation. He was head of production by the time we left there. So he was really an operational guy, but with a qualification of a CA. And when he came into Boland Bank, he sort of simply, he was more of a numbers guy than a real hard asset guy. So whereas he had been successful in production of liquor, when he came into the world of it's a virtual world, you know. When you talk, say, virtual products, people always think very exotic new things. But a thing like a savings account or a loan is really a virtual product. It's not a physical problem. It's something that's conceptualized in your mind, and you can describe it mathematically, but you can't touch it. And you will be surprised how many people find that difficult to deal with. Anybody can pack 12 bottles of liquor into a crate, but if you give them numbers and concepts to work with, you find that a lot of people simply, it doesn't appeal to them. And Rian loved it, so he flourished in that environment, and we met a few guys that we thought were very smart, particularly the IT guy who's just retired, and he'd been with Boland his whole life. And then when at a stage we started Capitec Bank, Boland had been taken over by Nedbank, and Nedbank had decided to close down the Paul headquarters, move it to Johannesburg, and all these old Cape Townians didn't want to go, so we could pull in a lot of them. And having worked there gave us the advantage that we knew with the smart guys, so we could say we want you and you and you. So the transition is big, it's different, but to some extent it's not as big as you think. It goes about organization, about logic, about managing people, training people. It's sometimes it looks massive, in some respects it is, but sometimes it's actually very similar. Dealing with teams of people, you've got to work out plans, you've got to... The biggest difference, I would say, the funny thing about banking is that if you look at the movies, you see these guys doing a big deal, and now they've signed. Then they jump up and they say thank you to the banker who's providing $1 billion to buy the other company. Now, just think of that. You've just given this bank $1 billion worth of business, and you thank them. In every other business, when you buy something, you buy a big new car, the salesman says, thank you for supporting my company. Here's a bottle of champagne. But in banking, the relationship is inverted. The people want to borrow from the bank, and that's a privilege. So they treat the bank as though the bank is more important than they are. The client should always be more important. And that's a very difficult thing to do. People, we found, for instance, that our staff become arrogant. They deal with people condescendingly. If people want loans, they will ask them, what for? And do you really think it's necessary? And I don't think you should do this. And so we've, at Capitec Bank, we simply said, you never ask anybody what for. That's a humiliating question. It's his money. If he can repay it, whether he wants to buy beer or wants to send his son to university, it's his choice. Treat him like a grown-up. Don't treat him like condescending. And so that, to my mind, is the biggest difference between selling liquor and selling. In the liquor world, you never forget that the client is king. In the banking world, the staff ends up thinking they're the kings. The staff is sort of there to help the customers must pay obeisance to the bank and not the other way. In a micro lending branch, the customer was king, and he got good service. Now, everybody else had this image that the customer was being exploited and humiliated. And yet, in real life, people were being well-treated. They paid exorbitant fees, and that's precisely why they were being well-treated, because a customer was important. Whereas in the bank, the customer was often treated with disdain. A poor laborer who came into a Boland Bank branch, and he has a problem, and he can't even quite express the problem, because there's a problem with the monies and the dates, and he doesn't, but his English is not good enough to really clearly explain what he can't understand. You can just see the service consultant getting, now I'm going to waste 10 minutes explaining something to somebody, and I'm not going to make any money for the bank. Whereas in the micro-lending environment, it was a highly priced bank. So I developed this idea that if we built a bank, we could reduce fees dramatically, we could provide full banking services, not only expensive loans. And I came back and I suggested that to my colleagues, and they then became my colleagues. I thought it was a good idea, and we started the idea that it was to become Capitec Bank. And then eventually I could persuade my friend from Wollombeck to join me, and they walked in, and then I said, look, I think there's a place for the bank. But my idea was a very traditional, boring bank, focusing on the poor people in the country. And Rian sort of said, oh, that's a bad idea. If we build a bank, it's got to be smart and innovative. And I was actually, at that stage, critical. I mean, a card was, and actually still is, it's a complex product to many of our clients. They like a little book with numbers that they can always check. So we spent a lot of time explaining to people, you could put this card into a machine at any time and see your balance, at any time, any place. Because people love knowing what their balance is. And they hate this idea of you've got a balance on the card, then suddenly you go back and a lot of the money is gone. And the bank has taken fees and this and that. So it remains a big concern to people. But if you asked whether we had it from the beginning, I can honestly say I didn't have the idea of being a creative bank. I had the idea of being a very conservative, old-fashioned bank for let's call it old-fashioned people without sophistication. And Rian said, no way, we're going to do something. It's got to be so smart that other people would like to come too. Banking is ultimately simply about IT. IT is a rapidly developing environment. Sometimes we are very much concerned that 10 years ago we were in the forefront. What we introduced then has become standard. And it's difficult to keep on introducing stuff. If you become big as well, your IT systems become hugely complex. To introduce something new is much more difficult than it was when you were small. If we do something new now, we always train up our staff. We never want to embarrass our staff that there's a new product, I don't know how it works, and the client walks in and there's embarrassment all around and frustration. So, but training staff when you've got 7,000 branch staff is very, very difficult and expensive. So at this stage, I think we're still doing that, but I mean, what else can you do? You can only try and preach to the converted, keep on repeating that innovation must be what we're all about, and if we stand still, we run the risk of being overtaken by other players, but that's a concern.
Any hobbies?
No.
Golf?
No, I don't play golf. It's part of the Capitec ethos, we don't play golf. Old bankers do. We've been profitable, I think, mainly because the other banks have been slow to react. Part of, also remember this, that if you come into a business, let me take a particular example. When you write a check, and I don't know any bank still issue checkbooks, but if you write a check, then you pay a fee on the check based on the value of the check. And that's for practical reasons. A check is a piece of paper. That's got to be sent to a central point, it's got to be cleared, it's got to be sent from, I wrote a check and I gave it to you and you gave my Standard Bank check to somebody who banks at Nedbank, and they've got to exchange that piece of paper and then they've got to give the money from this one bank to that bank. It's an intensive process and there's a lot of risk involved. But if somebody steals that piece of paper or changes the numbers, so it's got to be a highly controlled process. And for that reason, if you write a 100,000 rand check, it's going to cost you more than when you want to write a 100 rand check. If you make an internet transfer, zip problems, your risk, you do it. You make a mistake, sorry lady, your mistake. And there's no difference between a 100 rand transfer and a 100,000 rand transfer. So at Capitec, we charge you, I think, 1.75 rand for a transfer, internet transfer. Most of the big banks, you'll find, they still charge you. For a 100,000 rand check, they're going to charge you 25 rands. Now, why do they do that? Because they've been used to the income of 25 rands. If they now suddenly drop to 1.50 rand, they're losing 23.50 rand. So even though it's a simpler process, the big organization can't live on this starvation diet. And that's the advantage of new companies, because to us, 1.50 is 1.50. It's a wonderful growth in income. To them, 1.50 is a loss of 3.50 that they used to make. So in the internet era, where costs drop dramatically, the newcomer has the advantage of saying every transaction is new income. And the old incumbent sits there and is trying to defend his income streams. And every new transaction is a loss compared to what he used to get. So to us, it's been very easy. I mean, as we got momentum, we were cheaper, we remained cheaper, we got more people. It's just worked like a dream. If you imply what's our sort of social dimension of what we do, I can just say this, that you can judge whether it's a social or a business case. But our case, our belief is that, I used to say when I grew up, my grandfather was in the Platteland and he was a farmer. He came to town once a week and he bathed and shaved once a week. And he didn't really like doing money business. And he believed in his bank, his insurance company, and the co-op. And we move fast forward 100 years or 50 years or 80 years. People are highly skeptical about their bank and about the insurance company. In fact, the insurance companies hardly ever sell long-term policies anymore, because people have discovered that if you buy a policy, you pay 50 years, and you retire, you don't get what they promised you, because they are fees, this and that. So what did they do? They sacrificed their credibility for the sake of profitability. And I say that's a stupid thing. It's a stupid decision. So we've taken the decision at Capitec, and I don't want to sound pompous, but if we're going to do something, we're going to be transparent. I mean, Willem Bank has taught me that the banks are actually not innovative or client-oriented, and that there is a real gap, and that the fees they charge are high, so that it's possible. I must also say, to complete my sentence, it's possible to break a profit and charge considerably less on transactions than the other banks do. The advantage we had was the micro-lending business, particularly at the beginning, was a highly profitable business, and having an income stream from another source created the ability to build a bank and to be able to afford it. Because one of your big risks in business is that people, shareholders, hate losses. So if you ask people to start a bank, you need a lot of money. And if you have we had 300 million rands. If you had 300 million rands of somebody else's money and you produce losses, I can assure you they don't like it. And even if you tell them, this is my plan, you'll have losses for 2 years and then we'll make profit, they accept it and I agree to it, and after about 3 months, they don't like it anymore. People don't like losses. And so it's part of the reason why business banking is difficult, because it's there. So if you want to start a new business bank, you'll have to make very significant investments before you turn profits. And it'll be hard. I learned, one of the lessons I learned was that shareholders hate the ride. So even if the ride is as predicted, they still hate the ride. So if one can start a business and not, I mean, that's the story of a lot of startups, a lot of tech startups. I think the Americans have maybe perfected it, where they sell the dream of future successes or number of clients or number of hits, and people can accept the losses. I don't know. I'd love to be inside those boardrooms, because I sit in a small number of small companies as well, and I would say it's making losses and building a business is a very tough place to be. Remember, from a company point of view, it's difficult to, you don't want to underpay people. In fact, you always prefer to overpay, because you want to say my people are better than the average, and therefore I pay them a bit more. At the same time, that's your biggest cost. So if they're not really better, if they don't produce more income, you're just going to end up in a loss-making situation. So your salary bill is your biggest single differential that you've got to manage every month. And but the biggest discipline is losing people, because if you lose smart people, right, you lose them for money, then you know you're paying to look. If you appoint new people all the time, you know what you've got to pay to get good people. If your staff is very loyal and they stay with you for a long time, you've got a smallish group of people in an attorney's office and they've been there for 10 years, you don't know what these people are paid anymore. And I can tell you, a boss always thinks that what his people earn is a job. That's just part of business. And so the incentive to underpay is, it's a temptation that doesn't work. I always believe that you must have, well, 3 months' salary in cash in the bank, so that if your boss, if you don't like your boss, you can walk out of the door. I never wanted to say, I hate this place, but I've got to stay, because I've got payments and my house rent and everything. So I've been a saver my whole life. Being in the bank, you have the advantage of seeing other people's money management. My belief is that about 85% of people live beyond their means. They might earn a hell of a lot, but they're always battling because their expenses is always just a little bit more than their income, no matter how much their income. And I can talk about highly remunerated people. They, if they get a salary increase, then for 4 months they can live, and then their expenses start exceeding again. And 15% of people live below their income. They're always conservative, they always have more money, they spend less than they can afford to spend, and they don't allow their wives nice things because they're saving even when they can afford smart things. And I think it's better to be part of the 15% than part of the 85%. Our bank didn't exist if people didn't live beyond their means. When we started out with the new South Africa 20 years ago, there was a wonderful sense of excitement and innovation and creativity. And to my mind, we've lost a lot of that. We no longer have that sense that we're moving forward and we're resolving issues and getting them behind us. So, but I don't think it's unnatural. I think that's the way countries work, political setups work. I don't want to talk too much politics, but I think there's a clear sense that the ANC has been in government for a long time, and it's no longer as powerful in terms of ideas or innovation as it used to be. The whole banking crisis creates the impression in the public mind and the government's mind that a bank failure is a catastrophe. I think that's bad, because that means that they become very conservative with granting new licenses, and that means that it's a big protection for the incumbents. And now we're an incumbent, so I should be happy about that. But from a purely business point of view, when I was in the liquor industry is much, the wine industry is a relatively small industry. And in the wine industry, there are hundreds of small guys making their own little wine, and every week another guy opens up shop and tries. In banking, you don't have new money. Just simply, it's impossible to get a license practically. And I think that's stupid. I think the idea that government must sort of guarantee every new bank that they will be able to repay their depositors is not healthy. It creates a defensive mindset. So I don't think we're going to see a lot of new banks. I think governments everywhere has become much more cautious about granting new banking licenses. Discovery probably will get one, and I would be very much concerned about that. I mean, they're a very smart, innovative, creative company, and if they come in fresh now, they can think out of the box, and they might well think of things that we've missed. So I don't want to be arrogant, but I'm sometimes arrogant that the four big banks are not hard competitors. That's obviously not true. They're smart organizations. I think they're very smart organizations. But I do think that they manage very complex organizations. Capitec is the advantage of taking a small slice of what APSA does, and we concentrate on that. And we can be a lot better than they can be at managing this huge spread of businesses. But the way they manage a big spread of business is pretty impressive. But they find it difficult to compete with us in the small niche that we've chosen and that we think we can be better than that. There were times when Capitec was difficult. I had a very firm belief that Capitec was going to succeed. And I was in the fortunate position that I made some money at Woolland Bank on share options. So when we listed Capitec Bank, I was a happy buyer of everybody who was wanting to sell. And I bought lots of shares, and that's been very fortunate for me. But the fact is that I had a very firm belief that the model that we had to work. I mean, I still believe business is about people. The team of people that created the bank were old friends of mine. I knew exactly how smart they are. The business model had to work. The profitability was there. We had our awkward moments. When we listed in 2002, we made some losses the first few months. In April 2002, we didn't have enough money to pay the salary bill. Three of us shareholders could personally lend the money. I had cash because I wanted to buy shares. We could personally lend money to the company to pay. But that was never difficult. I always knew this thing is going to work. And it's been massively more successful than I had ever hoped or dreamt. But it was not, I don't know, you've got to believe in yourself. You don't have, if you believe so much in yourself that you're a fool, then you can turn out to be a real fool. So I don't know how to find the right balance, but you can't start something and not believe in yourself. You can't start something and wonder every day and every morning when you get up, is this the right thing to do? And at some point, because I gotta say, we're gonna make this happen, and then you've gotta commit. But I've been very fortunate in my life. I've got a wonderful family, lots of children and grandchildren, and it gives me a lot of pleasure. So I've never had a problem in motivating myself. I believe the biggest thing in life is that one must create your own life. You mustn't allow your life to be shaped by the forces of your family or what other people expect. I hate it when people sit in a job and they complain day after day and they hate their boss and they hate their job and they hate going to office. I say, no, leave, do something else. Don't sit there and say, you've got lots of choices. We live in a free country. Create choices, create opportunities. That's why I say save a little bit of money. Money gives you opportunities. You can afford to do something. If you've got a bit of cash in the bank, if you've got lots of debt and no cash, boy, you're tied up. But don't ever end up in a situation where you say, I hate my life and I don't know what to do about it. You can be, I mean, if you're unlucky, you end up there maybe by default in your middle life. But as a youngster, boy, you've got to choose your own life and make your own life happen. And I do think South Africa offers you opportunities. It's not a perfect country, it's not a perfect world, it's not as though everybody gets everything they dream about. But there are lots of opportunities of doing something better, shaping your own life. Well, when I was young, I worked for the Rupert organization, and Anton Rupert in our generation was a colossus. He was a Stellenbosch guy who started the World Empire. To this day, it's a hugely impressive organization. He did many things that I thought was that I didn't emulate, because, I mean, for instance, he was a man that believed, and I want to be careful, I don't want to say anything negative, I didn't know him so well, so maybe I'm not even right, but he wanted people to do what he said. He didn't like to have alternative suggestions and say, let's, here's a better way, why should we do it this way? He was a thinker, and he liked other people to be implementers. And personally, I try at Capitec Bank to do the opposite. I like to appoint smart people that you say, this is the problem, you solve it, it's not my problem. And so you don't necessarily, I mean, personalities differ, and times differ, so you don't necessarily take over everything that they teach you. Then I was privileged at university. Koos Dekker was in my section in Gendrach. He was the first year, I was the fifth year. And we've remained friends, and he's a very smart guy. He's created the world empire of his own. But there are lots of smart people. And South Africa, I think, there's a lot of inspiring people. To throw out a wild card, I've met a guy called Zaki Ahmad. He's become a great friend. Now, he's a guy who drove the treatment action campaign, and he's an activist. Very much a different attitude towards life and the world to myself. The reason I don't like activism of that kind is I believe in you create your own solutions. You don't stand on the street with a placard and try to force somebody else to create a solution. But that's as I say, in the end, it's personality. It's not logic. It's not pure logic that makes that difference. And so I meet this guy, and I thought I wouldn't like him, and we clicked, and he's a very good friend of mine. And he's a very inspiring man, but very different. So life is full of very interesting situations if you allow yourself to be open to experience it. Phew. It's very, very difficult to remember. I've always been marginally interested in politics. I was heavily involved in student politics. I decided politics won't work for me. It's not going to work for me to try and agree in big fora. And so I came quite easily to the conclusion that business is interesting and I'd like to succeed in business.
Have you ever considered expanding Capitec to the rest of Africa?
Yes, we have very much. Again, when we started out, we actually were much more interested. We thought much more globally and strategically, products, we'll do this and then we'll do that. And then when you really succeed, as I explained just now, it absorbs your management time, and your ability to create new stuff is limited by the success of the initial one. And so what I can tell you is that we definitely dream about going into other countries, but that dream is receding. I suspect that it probably is not going to happen. It's simply part of the problem is that banking is a very regulated and some quite often politically driven business. So whereas if you are Checkers and you want to open a store in Namibia, you can open one store in Vintage and see how it goes. You can't open one branch of Capitec. You've got to get a banking license, a local partner, set up a capital structure, do everything, and then you set up one branch and decide this is not for me. So it's a much more bigger commitment. Trading stores can simply start trading, because ultimately, what's the difference between being in Springbok and being in Carcamas? I mean, there's no real difference. So we should be able to expand quite easily. But I don't think we're going to do it very easily. I don't think we have looked at other countries, but also we're a very highly internet-driven organization. If you go into a country like, Mozambique, where electricity supply is dubious, it sort of destroys our system, because we can't afford to have a generator at every branch, and you need a reliable internet infrastructure. Otherwise, you can't operate a central system. So if we go over outside of South Africa, we would probably go to a country that's more like South Africa, middle income, not quite as low income as, say, Mozambique. So we think places like Poland or Mexico or Chile could be interesting, probably more than South Africa. And then when you talk like that and you say, who speaks Polish? It's really a massive decision. Now, I worked, Anton Rupert, he started in the 50s. You know, hardly anybody ever traveled overseas. He started in Stellenbosch, and before he had really succeeded with Rembrandt in South Africa, he would send two guys, one to start a factory and one to sell the cigarettes. And he would send teams of two young guys, I suspect they were all white, male, probably African speaker, but he would send two to Canada, two to Zambia, two to Malaysia, two to Singapore, and say, start a cigarette company. Now, it's so audacious, it's unbelievable. And he succeeded. He created a world empire. So it can be done, but that's part of the reason why I thought we really, if we're successful in South Africa, we need to emulate that. But I think that dream is receding. If we really have this capacity, we'll probably do something like business banking in South Africa rather than try to go to Poland and try and start a banking operation. Before you can open a single account in Zambia, you need to comply with banking regulations in Zambia. They probably have maximum and minimum interest rates legislation. Now Zambia would be relatively straightforward. It's a country that's not too dissimilar from South Africa. It's English speaking officially. But officially doesn't mean a hell of a lot. I mean, part of the Capitec recipe is that people must be served in their own language. It's nice to pretend that everybody is English, but if a Xhosa speaking laborer walks into a bank and he's got to explain in English, he finds it difficult. So in the Cape, in every branch, staff must be able to respond in easy Xhosa. And so it's always a bit more complicated than opening a trading operation. I'm very defensive. I'd love to be able to do it. This idea of Anton Lupitz to me always seemed like a beacon. So I send two guys out in the wide world and say, start a business. And then, and you know, sometimes he didn't even give them money. He just said, you find the money, you go to your bank. We don't have the money. And he created a successful business. Okay, they had their moments. They had a few problems, but overwhelmingly they had successes. The basic reason we started here is because we live here. So by the time we realized that this is not a terribly good idea, because Stellenbosch is an expensive town to buy houses, and the roads are clogged in the morning, and we decided to we should have a professional view of, and we appointed this small committee and say, if you had to start Capitec today, where would you site the head office? And they came back with a report that either probably in the northern, along not too from the highway and the railway lines in Brackenfell or something. And they identified a site there, and we started discussing it, and our staff nearly went ballistic. They said, lots of them said, we sold our houses, we moved, and now you want to move the company. That's unacceptable. So we, in the end, we just chucked in the towel and we stayed here. And it's still not it's not the best place. It's an awkward, it's not a little, just our biggest problem is flow of staff and housing. Housing is very expensive. So we've started a administrative head office in Belleville, but I don't see us moving. In terms of your question, look, being in Stellenbosch instead of a place like Johannesburg has all sorts of implications. I think they're mostly positive. Like people, Johannesburg is a vibrant city. Obviously, if you want to live in Stellenbosch, you've got to travel a lot. If you live in Johannesburg, you travel much less because of all your important things happen right there. But at the same time, I think people in Johannesburg can be more insular in a funny way because I think Johannesburg is everything. So it's a lot, but it's not by no means everything. They ignore the plot. And we started in the plot. We found the cities are highly competitive. The cities are more difficult to switch people in cities. In the small town, it's straightforward. And so we started out with a heavy emphasis in small towns, and that worked wonderfully for us. Now, if we had our head office in Johannesburg, I think we probably would have started out with an emphasis in Johannesburg. It's just natural. In terms of politics, no, we've never found anybody in government finding anything strange on the fact that we sit in Stellenbosch. As you grow, lots of things needs to be done. And you don't want entrepreneurship, you just want efficiency. So a big part of your organization focuses on efficiency and action. And applying the current rules. And to create, so what we do is we create small teams of people, often ad hoc teams. In other words, you will take three or four people out of different departments and put them together and say you've got 3 months to look at the future of mobile banking. and go overseas and attend this conference and peek and think out of the box. But it remains a challenge, because even when such teams can feed in interesting ideas, but ultimately the organization must make a choice whether it's going to accept those ideas or those proposals. And something I think we remain very active, we're aware of it. Other things, as we've discussed now, about expanding outside of the borders of South Africa, we've simply found we don't have the capacity. There's a lot to be learned from established companies. So the idea of working for a company for a number of years and learning and seeing what they do and how they do it is interesting. There's always a challenge, and that challenge is that if you're a smart person and you work for a company and you get regular raises and interesting challenges, and when you look back, you suddenly realize you've been there for 15 years and you wanted to start a business, but every time you think, maybe I should start, you've got a new opportunity and a nice big bonus, this and that. And so good employment can be it can take away the entrepreneurial spirit. At the same time, you're sometimes very naive when you start. When I speak to young people, they sometimes come with ideas that's really very patently impractical. You think, if this guy just worked for a few months in the industry, he would have realized this idea is not a good idea. So I don't know exactly where to start. So it's a very, being creative can be a very lonely process. It can also be a very it's a challenge to know exactly when you've got a good idea and when you've got a bad idea, when you must give up and when you must persevere. I can't really give you advice of how you find the middle balance between those conflicting views.